As I was thinking about how I wanted to share my testimony this morning, I really came back to one phrase, and it's this phrase that I learned when I was a freshman at Pepperdine University in California. Don't bury the lead. Don't bury the lead is something that I learned from my favorite teacher at Pepperdine, Marilyn Becker, who shared with me, don't bury the lead, Scott, when you're writing a story. In other words, make sure that the most important fact of the story is the first thing out of your mouth. Don't put it in the middle of your story. Don't put it in the end of the story. Don't bury the lead. And so when I speak to church groups and when I speak to groups this morning and I share my story, I want to make sure that you know that the most important thing in my life is my relationship with Jesus Christ. Jesus is my Lord and Savior. That is the most important thing. Beyond all the TV stuff, which I enjoy, you need to know how important my relationship is with Christ. And particularly this year, it's important that you know that Jesus has saved my life, by my count, 3 times. Once when I was a 10-year-old in Southern California, going to a church camp, and the youth pastor, after being with a bunch of kids throughout the weekend, asked, is there anybody who would like to give their life to Christ? And I was one of the kids who stayed in the church family and accepted Christ as my Lord and Savior. So that was the first time. The second time was when I was about 19 at Pepperdine, struggling with panic attacks. I don't know why I went through panic attacks, but it started when I was a freshman. I would get these sweaty palms and a racing heartbeat and an upset stomach. These panic attacks would strike when I was in class. They ended up impacting me when I was at basketball games and movie theaters and restaurants. I couldn't be in the center of a room. I needed to be near the exit. Couldn't stand and give my testimony. I couldn't sit in the front of a movie theater or a church. I had to be back at the door where the symptoms would go away. Now, these panic attacks I referred to as a monster, and Janae and I were high school sweethearts, and so she wrote out these panic attacks with me. And I can tell you that these panic attacks were horrible. They impacted every area of my life. I didn't know why that was happening, and when I was praying for God's healing, what I was getting from heaven was silence. I couldn't understand why the prayers that I was asking for healing were not being answered the way I wanted. I became frustrated and ultimately angry that God wasn't healing me the way I want. Well, this just in, panic attacks are not good for people who want to be on TV. You can't just get up from an anchor desk and go over to the exit. You can't do that. These panic attacks were with me for almost a decade, following me around from job to job, from Palm Springs to Hawaii, where I ultimately had to resign my job as a sportscaster in Hawaii because these panic attacks were so severe. Imagine leaving a job in Hawaii. It must have been pretty bad. And they were. They were really bad. My frustration, my anger with God was misplaced, and now in the rearview mirror, I realized I was wrong. What was happening is God was allowing me to go through a valley, go through a trial, go through a challenge, knowing all along that He was preparing me for something greater. God does that, allowing us to go through challenges, allowing us to go through struggles, knowing that His plans for our life are perfect. His timing is perfect. Now, I got out of TV for a while because these panic attacks were so bad. And when I got out of TV and found another occupation for about 5 years, those panic attacks went away. I prayed that God would allow me to get back into local TV news. I was out in California. I prayed that God would allow me to get back into the career that I wanted to be in since I was 15. Of all the places, of all the phone calls to get for a native son in California, the phone rang and it was Indianapolis. I did never been to India, but I knew that Janae's sister had married a guy from Lawrence Central, and they moved her family here, and they loved it. And so I ended up coming out and interviewing for a job, taking the job, and remembering that first night back on TV. Now, it had been 5 years since I'd been on TV, and I wondered, would those panic attacks resurface? I remember sitting on the anchor set, the newscast started, I started reading the news. The newscast ended, no panic attack. That was 1996, 21 years ago. I haven't had a panic attack since. And as I look at that healing period that took place, I knew that God healed me at just the right point, because it was God's plan for my life. God's timing is perfect. And so for 21 years, my testimony was just that. It was all about waiting on God's timing and waiting on God's plan. No matter what challenge or struggle you may be dealing with, that became my testimony. And I would travel all over Indiana at church groups and sharing my testimony and reminding people that no matter what kind of setback or challenge or difficulty that you might be facing, as believers, we need to trust in the sovereignty of God. God is on the throne. That God loves us, that God cares about us, that God's will is perfect for us. So for 21 years, that was my testimony. Until April of this year. April of this year, I was having a stomach ache. It had gone on about 5 days. Janae was on a business trip. My kids were scattered in different states. And I just got off the news. The stomach ache was just getting worse. And as wives usually do, they know what to say. And so Janae told me, you know what? You really need to get to a doctor. Now, I had wrote off this stomach ache thinking that it was something else that I had been dealing with off and on for a couple of years. And so I basically wrote the thing off, as men often do. But I took my wife's advice and decided, you know what, I do need to go check this out. So I drove myself to a hospital. Again, something I don't recommend now. Drove myself to a hospital, checked myself into the emergency room. They ran some tests, came back and said, Scott, you're bleeding internally. Now by this time, I was really going downhill. My blood pressure was 50 over 30. I was now in critical condition. I was going in and out of consciousness. I was in bad shape. I would later learn from the doctor that I was near death. I was in really bad shape. They couldn't treat me at the small hospital in Fishers. They needed to move me to a larger hospital. It was hailing that night, and so the medical helicopter, well, that option was out. So we're going to load you in the back of an ambulance. And my brother-in-law is a battalion chief of the Fishers Fire Department, and he was on the scene. He helped load me into the ambulance. They were giving me blood, 4 units of blood. And as I was, again, really spiraling downhill, hear voices of the paramedics, of the other hospital workers treating me, but I could not open my eyes and I could not speak, but I could hear voices. I would later learn that the paramedics weren't sure that I would survive the 15-minute paramedic ride from Fishers to Indianapolis. They didn't think I was going to live. What had happened was an artery near my stomach had burst. More on that in a moment, but as I got in the ambulance, I could hear the paramedics describe the streets that we were passing. We're passing Keystone, passing Meridian, getting off on Meridian. What I believe as a Christian is this great verse in Scripture in Romans that talks about in our weakness. The Holy Spirit intercedes for us with groans that words can't understand, providing them peace. I believe that was what was happening in the back of that ambulance. The Holy Spirit was interceding for me in my weakness because I couldn't open my eyes, couldn't talk. God was interceding for me. for me. During that ambulance ride, somehow, the bleeding stopped. When I arrived at St. V's on 86th Street, the doctor who treated me in the emergency room didn't really have a good explanation as to why that artery had stopped bleeding. I know. As a Christian, I know and believe that Jesus healed me. I'm convinced of it. The doctor still to this day can't explain why that happened. But I'm so thankful, so grateful that God healed me. I believe God healed me because he knew that this day was coming. He knew I had an opportunity to share my faith with family and heritage. The very people who helped support and guide and shape my children needed to hear a story of hope and healing from God Almighty. Great Creator, Sovereign God, God I count on every day, the God I am grateful for every breath, every day. God wanted to share that with you. 12 days in the hospital, they determined that I had this rare disease called vascularized panic. What? Vascularized panic? I've never heard of it. Well, it turns out not many people have. Ended up going to the Cleveland Clinic. They specialize in this kind of disease. And the doctor who saw me said that in 7 years, they treat 100 people with this disease. So it's very rare. This disease attacks. Is your body attacking the arteries, thinking that it's a foreign object? Why this happened to me, I'm not sure. And they determined that this is a disease that had obviously been undiagnosed, but something that had been going on inside my body for several years. I suppose this explains why a couple of times I passed out and had stomach pain. And so perhaps that's the reason for this disease. But they were assuring me throughout that if I spent time taking the right medicines, that this would go into remission. That 3 months of these two drugs would put this disease into remission. And so that's the treatment plan that I went through. I lost about 20 pounds along the way, took these two drugs, had some side effects that were just, you know, not big deals. But watched God end up preparing me for healing. I spent a lot of time in prayer and a lot of time in Psalms. Psalms is a great place to hang out when you're going through a trial. I love how David talks about, with great honesty, the challenges that he goes through, the highs and lows of his life. And there's a great psalm in there, Psalm 30, verse 2, that talks about healing. God, I called on you and you healed me. I hung on that verse. Believe in that verse. 2 weeks ago, I went in for an update, another CT scan. And they compared the original one that I had the day that I almost bled to death with the one I just had 2 weeks ago. Doctors looked, compared things, and were amazed at the healing that took place. There is no sign of disease now in me. That's just amazing, and that's God doing it. Now, I can't explain it, and I certainly can't explain why it happened to me and it doesn't happen to everyone. That I can't explain. I don't know. I don't know on this side of heaven why that happened. Only to know that God may not be done with it. God's got opportunities for me to share my faith. At the beginning of every year, I take a long walk down the dikes, and I pray that God would open up opportunities, giving me a platform to share my faith. So when Jeff called and asked me to come and speak, for me, that's an opportunity. That's an answer to prayer, to be able to share with you and encourage you wherever you are on your faith journey. Whatever struggle or challenge that you may be going through, we love and serve God that can do anything.